All right, welcome back from that short break. And now, of course, our kachai still continues as we're getting to have another conversation twister regarding conservation. Now, this particular point in time, I'm joined by Honorable Hilary Rakwang. That's, of course, coming in from Ake County in Kabong District. Good morning to you, Honorable.
Good morning.
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
It's good to join us on our conversation here. We've been talking about conservation, and I would like to get, you know, your point of view regarding conservation from your people in Kabong District. How have you guys spearheaded this, and how are you doing it to make sure that you achieve the main goal of it all?
Thank you very much. To the viewers, first of all, my name is Rakwang Hilary. I'm a member of parliament representing people of Ake County in Kabong District. Mm. I'm also very grateful to be with the senator, very important person from US. It's not actually, I have been in US some time back. And I attended the Indigenous People's Forum, the 14th session at the UN headquarters. And most of these things were about the environmental challenges faced by indigenous people. Back to Kabong District, one of the issues that, the measures that we have been able to handle the issues of environment was the issue of burning the environment. That's one of the issues. Then the other thing is about the charcoal burning. Of course, there is fire burning of the entire environment, because as pastoralists, people, when they graze those areas, like for example the Timu Forest Reserve and then the Morongole Forest Reserve, so we have been able to sensitize people that it's not good to burn, because sometimes the pastoralists want fresh grass for the animals, but they don't know that they are destroying the environment. And also our neighbors from Kenya also do migrate during dry season to Uganda, and most of them graze in my area in Timu Forest Reserve. So sometimes we engage them in meetings and tell them that we should not burn the environment. And of course, many people I have gone to indigenous community, you know, the let me say the dominant groups having destroyed their environment, their land. They have gone as far as our communities also to look for fertile areas for cultivation, to look for pasture for their animals. So these people have destroyed the environment, but we have been trying to engage them to ensure that the environment should remain as it is. We should protect the ecosystem. We should protect the fauna and flora in those environments. So we have been able to.
That's very good. A couple of months ago, the government came out to, you know, displace your people and have a national park in place. I need to get your opinion regarding that. Were you in support of the people being displaced and for the national park, or you were not?
First of all, in early 1950s, around 1954, when Kidepo Valley National Park was founded, I'm told that time I was not there, but then I'm told that the Ake people used to have their gardens within the Kidepo Valley National Park. But the game rangers came and slashed all the gardens down. And then people were evicted to Mount Morongole, which is now currently the forest reserve. And when these people were evicted, they remained isolated in the forest. But after that, so the government said that no, these people might disappear, so we need to recognize them, because the Ake people are found of conserving the environment. We don't cut the trees. And when we are evicted, there was that agreement that the government should get, because we get what's called revenue sharing from the game park. The Ake people get revenue, all the communities surrounding the game parks. I'm sure even the Batwa people also get the revenue sharing, because those ones who are within the game. Because it's a policy, the government policy, that all the communities that are near the game parks, the game reserves, they should benefit.
Okay. Were your people compensated after they had been displaced?
No. My people were not compensated by them.
Okay, you have something in common
NFA,
with the
of
people.
Of course, with NFA, we signed what's called a committee collaborative agreement with the NFA, that we can stay freely in the forest. We can be part of the forest. Like, for example, in Kenya, we have a community called the Yaku community. They stay in the forest with the, even the wildlife.
Okay.
And also their animals graze within the forest. So I think that's where we are now moving.
Okay. So
because in Itimu we are now having coffee. We have opened 300 acres of coffee because coffee is environmentally friendly. So we see that instead of destroying the environment, let's also put coffee within the
What coffee are you measuring in? Is it Arabica or Robusta?
Yeah, I think it is Robusta coffee.
Robusta. Okay. Yeah. Now, let me cross over to, of course, the former center here, Feingold. I want us to weigh in with his conversation. Development vis-a-vis, you know, conservation of the environment. What is your take on that? Do you think what they did was, you know, a right move as far as, you know, conserving the environment is concerned, displacing people and having the national park put into existence?
I think looking back at the way this was done around the world, including in the DRC and other places, it probably was not the right way to do it. People thought, let's just turn this into a completely pure place with no human beings, but that's not the way it was for thousands of years. That's not really the environment. The environment included people. And the people actually understood and respected their home. And so it was a mistake, in my view, personally. Now, as your guest pointed out, we can do it differently. When I talk about preserving 30% of the land or resources around the world, this does not necessarily mean moving people out of new areas. There are ways in which a new preserved or protected areas can include the people who know it best, the indigenous peoples. And this is one of the principles of the Campaign for Nature. Yes, we want to preserve 30% by 2030. We want a much greater emphasis on the role that indigenous peoples can and should play. So I think this is an opportunity this time to get it right instead of pushing people out of their natural homes.
30 by 30, conserving the environment by 30%, that is, of course, by 2030. Do you think this is something that is achievable practically, having this kind of, you know, cases pop up? We talked about, you know, displacement of people because they want areas to settle in, farming as well. Do you think this practically is possible?
I do. Look, we've got scientists reporting in a huge report that came out in May that we're facing a level of extinction of species that is unheard of in human history, in fact, in the history of the planet. Up to a million species, they estimate, may become extinct. So the question is, how do we avoid that? When I say 30%, we're not saying it has to be 30% for each country. It's 30% overall. There are some places that are over 90%. There are some places that aren't going to be able to achieve 10%.
10%, yes.
Uganda is interesting because Uganda has already done a lot. According to the strictest estimates, Uganda has already preserved 16%.
All right.
According to some of the Ugandan government reports, they say they've already done 32%. So this includes parks, but it also includes forest areas and other areas. So this is why we think Uganda can be a real leader. It won't get up to 70%, but it may be able to get over 30%. But the main role that Uganda can play is to say, look, we have a complicated country where agriculture is important, where business is important, where indigenous peoples are important. All of these things have to be accommodated. And yet, Uganda is in the top 30, 35 countries in the world for biodiversity. It's a very special place for biodiversity, partly because of the places that the gentleman is from. So we think, this is why we think Uganda can be a leader, not by doing 90%, but by doing a significant amount and telling other people in the world how they did it.
Okay.
And that's why we're here, to meet with people like you, to talk to you, to get the people of the country to say, we're proud of what Uganda has done, but we want Uganda to commit to the 30 by 30 and to be a champion of the African and of countries around the world. So that, I wanted to make it clear, it's not 30% for each country.
Okay, yeah. Now, let us get back to how you plan on working with these people, the indigenous people in the country, the people that have been doing conservation for quite a long period of time. What are some of the mechanisms that you have in place to ensure that you drive your main goal home working with them?
Of course, the mechanisms aren't all in place because what we're trying to do right now is create this agreement that we think will go in place in October of 2020. But at that point, there should be a plan to implement this. So what does it mean? Well, let's say there's another area that's been determined in Uganda to be a natural protected area, but there are people living there, indigenous people. There have to be resources. There has to be money that comes from outside of Uganda, probably, maybe some from Uganda, to help these individuals live there, but also to help them do what they do so well, which is to help manage the park. So, you know, you can create as many natural areas as you want. If they're not properly managed, it doesn't work. They don't end up working. And so it involves resources, it involves respect and involvement of indigenous peoples, but it does involve national commitment to say, look, this area will be managed in this way, and we need help in financing.
Okay. Honorable, what is your take on, you know, having such campaigns happen in the country? He's spearheading a campaign for nature, and like you've had, what he's talking about is basically also looking at the bigger perspective, the bigger picture here. What is your take on, you know, whatever this campaign stands for?
Well, thank you very much. I think I should begin from the point of challenge, that one of the challenges in Uganda is that in the constitution, there is no word indigenous. It's not recognized. That's one of the challenges. Because we would be able to claim or to push on that, because we would be able to quote in the constitution that in the constitution this is what we are supposed to do, but we don't play the role in the constitution. And of course, one of the challenges is that the much of these things are more theoretical than practical. That there is no funding that is always allocated, like to these communities to protect the environment. If they, for example, are known as people who are conserving the forest, they would be given the money to conserve more, to increase more, more conservation in the forests, in the environment, so that other people, we can also become a role model. Other people come and see, so that they can learn from us. Look at Kampala. Kampala was supposed to be a forest. All these valleys, you have seen the water, there's nowhere water can escape. People are building the wetlands, they are putting factories. Everywhere, when you go around Kampala, would have just put a city somewhere. Look at so many areas, Namanve, the other side. It's just only factories.
Okay.
Where sugar farms are.
Honorable,
so
are you?
The challenge is we have not strategized on how best can we ensure that we bring back the environment.
Does that mean you're not contented with what the government is doing as far as, you know, conserving the environment right now?
Well, not actually to the extent that
you expected.
I expect.
Okay.
Because first of all, some other people, they have encroached, the big people in government. They are the ones even owning some of these chunks of land, which are supposed to be, you know, the wetlands. If you find people just putting rice in the wetlands, big acres, chunks of land. These are some of the government workers, people who are big in the government. But I think we need to amend the law.
Okay.
That whether there's nobody.
Good enough you're a member of parliament.
The government is trying its best to ensure that the environment is conserved at the individuals.
So we do hope that you can table this in parliament, since you are representative
Of course, we are ready to.
That's beautiful. We are running out of time, but former Senator, I need to get your last remarks regarding, you know, campaign for nature as we get to wrap up. What should be your last remarks?
Well, we're all in this together. This is an opportunity instead of disagreements, and there are way too many disagreements in the world. This is an opportunity for us all to work together. Every country in the world, all the peoples, it's just something that's so dangerous, along with climate change. We are in a very dangerous situation. We could have an extinction that could make it impossible for humans to even live. And that's what the scientists say.
Okay.
It's not just scaring people, but we can do something in America, in Uganda, and throughout the world to try to change it. So that's what we should all work on together.
It is a conversation that never ceases to come to an end, and we do hope that this time round we can make the best use out of it in order to make the environment a better place for us to live in. We're going to leave you with a short video that we managed to get from the people of Aike community and how they are living their lives regarding conservation. For more of what has been happening on the show, what we did talk about, head over to our Facebook page as well as Twitter to keep yourself informed. Here is the video from the people of Aike community.
The Ike community are a small minority ethnic group in the mountains of northeastern Uganda. Displaced from their land to create a national park, the Ike people lead a tough life in several small villages under harsh climate conditions and far away from access to services.
The people in Ike community are very vulnerable. They don't have access to education services, they don't have access to water, they don't have access to health facilities.
Various UN agencies have come together to respond to the complex challenges of the Ik people, providing health, education, food aid and child protection. Effective and sustainable developmental assistance has been brought to this remote and forgotten community. The new health center in Osaka serves five nearby villages, bringing basic health services nearer to the community. Right next to the health facility, UNICEF is supporting the building of a new primary school, providing a much-needed opportunity for the Ik children to receive an education. Since the introduction of the WFP feeding program, school attendance has increased significantly.
After I study, I want to become a nurse or a doctor. I'll make sure that I can treat people and give them drugs so that they can feel better.
In order to secure food and improve household income among the Ik, the Food and Agricultural Organization is training women to plant and position cassava on demonstration plots. The UN programs in the Ik community are an example of how the UN in Uganda has come together to improve the living conditions of a remote and especially vulnerable group of people. This is Karen Bridger reporting for UNICEF Television. For more information, go to unicef.org.